The one place where a man ought to get a square deal is in a courtroom, be he any color of the rainbow. This quote from To Kill a Mockingbird illustrates the age-old problem we have in this country regarding racial disparity in criminal justice. Our next panel will address where we are on this problem today. Have we solved the problem? I don't think I'll be stealing anyone's punchline here by telling you no. We haven't solved the problem of racial disparity. Our panel today will analyze where racial disparity exists in the criminal justice process, consider its causes and its effects, and we'll discuss what we can do to address it. Our moderator today will be Nancy Gertner. She is a former district judge from the District of Massachusetts until her retirement last year. She now is a professor of practice at Harvard Law School, where she teaches sentencing law. Sonia Starr is an assistant professor at University of Michigan Law School, where she teaches criminal law and focuses, among other things, on empirical analysis of racially disparate effects in criminal law. Brian Stevenson is the founder and executive director of Equal Justice Initiative in Montgomery, Alabama, and is also a professor at NYU School of Law. He is known most recently for his extraordinary victory in the case of Miller versus Alabama, the Supreme Court case we've been discussing throughout this conference, in which the Supreme Court held unconstitutional mandatory life without parole sentences for juveniles. And finally, we have Judge Ruben Castillo, district judge in the Northern District of Illinois. He spent 11 years on the Sentencing Commission, serving as vice chair until completing his service there in December of 2010. Please join me in welcoming Professor Gertner and our rest of our panelists.
I want to first begin by thanking Judge Mulway. In April, I received an email. I don't remember much about it. When I saw Maui, I said yes. So far as I knew, she was asking me to intone about astrophysics, but I had no idea. I also want to thank her remarkable staff. Brian Stevenson and I were saying there has never been a panel that I've ever been on in my life that had as many emails and conference calls as this. So I will be presenting a PowerPoint. I should say that the PowerPoint is also something that we did together. I'm a novice at PowerPoint, although I was a techie as a judge. I'm a novice at PowerPoint. I submitted a PowerPoint to them which no one could read, and happily they have tinkered with it. So my job here is to set the table. For the longest time when I was a district court judge, I straddled two worlds. On the one hand, I would go to conferences that sponsored by the United States Sentencing Commission with judges, judicial conferences, and we would talk about the guidelines and departures and variances. And then I would go to conferences in my capacity as a professor, then teaching at Yale. And I'd go to conferences with social scientists and with sociologists and be talking about entirely different issues. And it occurred to me that what was terribly important was that one group should begin to talk to the other. This panel is an effort to bridge that gap, to understand the implications of what we do. We're raising the question here, first about the pace of imprisonment in general, what I will describe as the problem of mass incarceration. Then we'll talk more specifically about racial patterns and their consequences. I'll be talking about state statistics, national statistics, and at a point when we talk about federal issues, I will turn the podium over to Ruben Castillo, who can understand the Sentencing Commission PowerPoints much better than I can. So I'm going to ask four questions. Always a good thing to do. What is the scope of disparity, racial disparity? What accounts for that disparity? What is the cost of that disparity? And if we get to it, what can be done about it? The first slide deals with, just to set the table in general, it deals with what has become to be known by social scientists as America's problem of mass incarceration. David Garland describes mass incarceration as a rate of imprisonment that is markedly above historical and the comparative norm for societies of this type. So we look at the United States versus Western Europe. The list describes the United Kingdom, Italy, Austria, etc. And then when we add the United States incarceration rate, we are there. Over 700 individuals per 100,000 citizens, by dimensions more than countries that we would otherwise be similar to. But if we look more broadly at the rate of the United States versus other countries, this is US versus worldwide. The United States still leads the world in mass incarceration. Our closest competitors are Rwanda, the Russian Federation, and Iran. And it's not a recent phenomenon. We tried to describe the changes in imprison rates over time. This was the imprison rate from 1925 to 1972. Scholars went on at great length about how the Massachusetts imprison, United States imprison rate was stable. And then in the late 70s, this happened. The imprisonment rate dramatically increased, and the issue of race fits more broadly into this general pattern. So it's not just the mass incarceration of everyone. We also want to talk about the extent to which this falls more on the backs of minorities, racial minorities, non-citizens as well. This slide describes the racial disparities, black, Hispanic, and white, since 2000. The lower level is the white numbers of individual sentenced prisoners per 100,000 by race. Lower level green is white. The middle is Hispanic. The top is black. That has remained stable, but stably disproportionate. This is another version of the same slide that essentially shows in block graph view the extraordinary disproportionate rate of incarceration of blacks and Hispanics. This is the Ninth Circuit's particular take on this. It compares the statistics in the general population with the percentages in prison. So with respect to blacks, although 5% of the population is black, 23% of those in prison are black. 29% of the population is Hispanic, 35% of the prison population is Hispanic. The statistics don't begin to describe what the issues really are. Mark Maurer writes that one in four African American young men before the age of 25 can expect to be in prison, parole, or on some kind of criminal justice supervision. One in nine African American men aged 20 to 34 winds up in prison. So what accounts for this? And that has to be an issue that we discuss. And one question which people will raise, and as I said, I'm just setting the table here, is this an appropriate response simply to the crime rate? Are we where we are because we are just a violent society? So this is a slide which describes the increase in incarceration, and this is the violent crime rate. In fact, this statistic doesn't even this slide doesn't as carefully describe the problem as we should. Homicide rates have dramatically decreased, all the while that imprisonment rates have increased. Scholars suggest there is simply a very limited relationship between the rate of imprisonment and crime control. Homicide rates have spiked and fallen all during the period of time that incarceration nevertheless continues. And as one scholar described it, beginning in 1992, aggregate rates of imprisonment declined steadily to less than 6%, a level not seen since the 1960s. So that by now, the level of, again, homicide is at a level not seen since the 1960s. But that has not at all stopped the imprisonment rate. And then with respect to the issue of racial minorities, there's no evidence, of course, that there is a crime, that the crime is anywhere near the numbers of imprisonment rate with respect to racial minorities. There's no indication that racial minorities commit the crimes that are of concern more than whites, more than other members of the society. So what accounts then for this disproportion between the numbers in the population and the numbers in our prisons. Well, there are structural factors that we'll talk about. Clearly, the war on drugs had enormous impact on the imprisonment rate. The extent to which we decided to punish crack cocaine use more than anything else had an enormous effect. And then there are also the discretionary decisions that all the actors in the system makes. Clearly, discretionary decisions about criminal justice issues enable biased decisions. But what distinguishes this panel, and what I'm particularly proud about, is that we want to examine the discretionary decisions of all the players: police, prosecutors, judges. Sometimes when I'm part of these conversations, I believe that we examine only the discretionary decisions of the last man or woman standing, which is usually us. I'm still identifying as a judge. Us, judges. So we want to talk about the impact of discretionary decisions, the cumulative impact of discretionary decisions all the way down the line. If police arrest minorities more than they arrest anyone in any other group, the prosecutors will charge more, the judges will get more in their courtroom. And we also want to talk about the complexities of these decisions. It's not just a question of discretion. Pure discretion means bias. If you exercise your discretion as a judge, for example, to consider education, and educational opportunities are unevenly distributed in this society, is that a race-based decision, or is that an appropriate decision? If you exercise your discretion to consider employment, and employment opportunities are unevenly distributed in this society, is that race-based, or is that appropriate? If you exercise your discretion to consider criminal record, to look carefully at criminal record, and in certain communities, minorities are arrested more than anyone else. In some communities, minorities are arrested based on traffic stops, for which whites are not arrested. Is that an appropriate exercise of discretion or not? If you exercise your discretion in a crack cocaine case, for example, in order to offset the racial imbalances that you have observed, is that an appropriate exercise of discretion or not? So just saying that there are discretionary decisions doesn't answer the question of why and doesn't address whether these are race-based or not. So then we want to talk about, even if this rate of incarceration matched the crime rate, even if it did and it does not, what are the costs of this level of incarceration? My source here is Bruce Western, who's a professor of sociology at Harvard, and this is really the part of the discussion that, as I said, I hear about in my sociology conferences. What's the impact of different rates of incarceration? Again, one impact is if this is because of race bias, it offends our fundamental notions of equality. But there's more. This is a chart that describes imprisonment and the life course of white and black men born between 75 and 1979, experience any one of these life events by the time they're, by 2009, by the time they're 30. So marriage, 68% of whites will achieve that by 30, 47% of blacks, college degree, 34%, 70% blacks. But the stunning statistic is, with respect to whites, 5% will be imprisoned, 27% of blacks will be imprisoned by who were born between 75 and 79. This is a chart about the employment rate. The top level is for black men who are high school dropouts. But the lower blue line is for black men who have been incarcerated. So the impact of incarceration on economic opportunity is dramatic. This is perhaps the most troubling slide of all. These are the numbers of children with incarcerated parents. So the bottom line deals with Hispanics, the middle line is white, the top is black. Professor Western describes this as disparity that is invisible because it is concentrated and segregated, cumulative because it affects economic opportunities and life choices when individuals get out of prison, but worse, if it could be worse, it is intergenerational. So there are costs to these disparities that we ought to look at. And then we want to talk about what to do about it, if there is anything to be done about it. The classic explanation for dealing with discretionary decisions for judges, I always loved this, for 17 years, was eliminate it. Eliminate discretion, mandatory minimums. It's very interesting that when we talk about police officers who may have discretionary decisions that have the same impact, we talk about training. We talk about education. We don't talk about eliminating arrest authority. So how do we deal with this? Information, training, sessions like this. But before we go to the broader discussion with our really quite extraordinary panel, I'm going to call Judge Castillo to come up to the podium so he can figure out the U.S. Sentencing Commission slides.
Well, hello. I don't know if I can figure out the commission slides. I will tell you this. I stand here, first of all, as a judge from another circuit, totally envious. I'm envious not about the location of this conference. During my 11 years on the Sentencing Commission, I was privileged to go to a lot of circuit conferences in many nice places. Many of them were outside the actual circuit. But I'm most envious about the content of the educational programs that you've put on. And in particular, this topic, which I know this topic is a difficult topic to take up after lunch. And yet, I can tell you this, I'm not aware of any other conference, including my own, that has ever taken up this topic of race and sentencing, especially at a plenary session. So I commend Judge Kaczynski, Judge Malway, the organizers of this conference, for taking on, for the first time in my knowledge, this very sensitive topic. Now I'm here because I'm a person on supervised release. I'm on supervised release from the Sentencing Commission. I served there for 11 years, and I have tried to convince Judge Breyer, who will soon hopefully represent the Ninth Circuit on the Sentencing Commission, that there is life after being on the Sentencing Commission. I'm going to try and explain what's been going on in federal sentencing. And let's see if I can get to the first chart.
There you go.
Okay. Just let me go back to that last one. Okay. See, right off the bat, ran into some issues. First of all, if you compare 1995 to 2010, the first thing that I'm going to emphasize, and I apologize if we're going to run through some of these charts, you all have them at your table. If you're really into these charts, there are more posted in connection with this great conference. But the first thing you should realize is just try and add up those numbers. All of you are working harder than ever. If you compare 1995 to 2010 and look at the numbers of defendants that are going through the federal criminal justice system, the next thing that should jump out at you is the big growth rate in Hispanic defendants. Why is that? Well, I don't need to tell any of you from Arizona or California why that is. The big growth consistently over the last 3 years in the federal criminal justice system has been for immigration offenses. That has been across the board. Even in places like Idaho, Illinois, there are more immigration cases than ever, as reflected by Attorney General Holder's recent decision to go national with fast-track programs. And you can see that sort of in the next chart. This just looks at U.S. citizens, but then look at the growth, that bottom red line, in non-U.S. citizens. It has continually grown over the last 5 or 6 years, exponentially. So let me go on. Nationally, we're seeing now Hispanic defendants representing 50% of the federal defendant population, and black defendants representing 20%. It's an easy to comprehend pie chart. If you look at the Ninth Circuit, you'll see that you have more Hispanic defendants and less black defendants. Now we get to the crux of the matter. Now I apologize for this, but this was a chart that, of course, I did not devise. This is a chart drawn up by the great PhDs at the Sentencing Commission, but I'm going to try and explain this to you. First of all, the different color zones depict different eras of federal sentencing. For those of you familiar with sentencing, and I know I don't have to explain the Kuhn decision to anyone in the Ninth Circuit, but it's been divided up into post-Kuhn, post-Protect Act, a point in time when the Congress tried to restrict federal discretion, post-Booker, that is post-January of 2005, when the guidelines became advisory, and post-Gaul, which some would see as one of the most liberal Supreme Court opinions that really emphasize, together with the recent Pepper decision, how sentencing needs to be individualized. What you can draw from this, very simplistically, is that if you happen to be a female, you are favored in the federal criminal justice system, no matter what your background is, whether or not you're a white female, a black female, or a Hispanic female, you are receiving sentences that are consistently anywhere from 1/4 to 1/3 lower than comparable males. That is the data of the Sentencing Commission. As to why that happens, I'm not going to try and speculate upon that. But the thing that is most striking to me, and I will tell you this has been debated over and over again, when I was a member of the Sentencing Commission, we put together this small report, March of 2010, and I will tell you, we sat around a room in DC and we went back and forth on the impact of this small report. Demographic differences in federal sentencing practices, an update on the Booker Report's multivariate regression analysis. And one of the predictions that I made that just completely turned out to be wrong, completely wrong, maybe for the good. The key finding that the U.S. Sentencing Commission made in this report, it's the first bullet point in the summary, and I'm just going to read it to you. Black male offenders receive longer sentences than white male offenders. The differences in sentence length have increased steadily since Booker, period. Now, I sat back and I thought to myself, as a member of the Sentencing Commission, not a radical group, I thought that this would be page one of the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Chicago Tribune. I could go on and on. And instead, what there was dead silence. Just dead silence. No one picked up on that point at all. I was flabbergasted. Instead, what has happened is that since our study, this study has been criticized numerous times by different PhDs. But I'll tell you, I am not aware of any study that has ever shown that there isn't a black male prison disparity rate that exists in the United States. The question is, why is it? Why is it? Now, if you look at this chart, the complicated chart, if you look at black male versus white male, that's the most significant part of this chart. And you can see that in the sort of post-Gaul era, there's still a 20% difference in the sentences between a black male and a white male. And that's controlling for every single factor. So you can't say, well, that's because of the type of offense. That is troubling to me, and it should be troubling to every single person in this room. That's not to say that there is discrimination. That's just to say that this is a fact. This is a fact, and it needs to be studied. You know, I look at that, and I'm not trying to make light of this, but I kind of think of Marvin Gaye's song, "What's Going On?" What's going on with that 20%? And I will tell you, I just sat down with a very distinguished researcher in Chicago and preparing for coming out here. His name is Kevin Blackwell at the U.S. Sentencing Commission. And I know that the Sentencing Commission is right now in the process of coming out with a new report that will be released, coincidentally, right after this next national election that we're having. And I asked Kevin, I said, is that number, that 20% number, is that number going to get better or is it going to get worse? And he could make no predictions to me about that number, about whether or not it was going to get better or worse. And I tell you what I told him at a little lunch table in Chicago. If that number goes from 20 to 30%, something is wrong. Something is seriously wrong. So my hope, my fondest hope, is that by having a conversation about all this, we can get that number down. That's not to say that there is any specific cause for that. There are a lot of different components, as Nancy mentioned. We're talking about prosecutorial discretion, cooperation, mandatory minimums, criminal history. The Sentencing Commission would be the first one to tell you they could not really account for violent criminal history. So that is the biggest hole in that particular number. But nevertheless, as I said before, there is not a study that I'm aware of that won't come up with some number that exists there. And in a perfect world, that number would no longer exist. And that is where I would like us to go to. I know the world is not perfect, so I look forward to the discussion that we're about to have. Thank you very much.
So at this point, we'll turn to Professor Starr, who wants to try to answer that question by looking at prosecutorial sentencing patterns.
So thank you so much. It's a real privilege to be here and to take part in this discussion. So with great respect to Judge Castillo and the important work of the Sentencing Commission, I'm going to do what we academics like to do the most, which is to criticize. My criticism is not just of the Sentencing Commission study, though. It's basically all of the existing empirical research on sentencing disparity does the same thing, which is to consider the sentencing decision in isolation from the rest of the criminal process. So they estimate gaps in sentence outcomes when controlling for many variables, the most important of which is the recommended sentence under the guidelines. Usually that's the bottom end of the guidelines range, is the control variable. When you use that method, the question being asked is, if you compare, say, blacks and whites whose cases land them in the same guidelines cell, do they get different sentences? Now, what those studies don't measure is disparities in all of the prior stages of the justice process that determine what guideline cell a case falls into. So charging, plea bargaining, sentencing, fact finding. And if there are disparities at those earlier stages, then this method is not making an apples to apples comparison. So blacks and whites in the same guideline cell might not have the same underlying facts of their cases, in which case comparing them could be misleading. So I think that it's important to focus on disparities across the justice process and not just in guidelines compliance. And so along with my co-author, Marit Rahavi, I set out to try to find a way to estimate disparities elsewhere in the process. And we do this by using a data set that traces cases from arrest through to sentencing. We linked the Sentencing Commission's data to data from other agencies on the same cases, including arrest stage data that comes from the Marshals Service and charging data that comes from the courts. And we used only post-Booker data from 2007 through 2009. We excluded immigration cases, so we're missing part of the important dynamic that Judge Castillo is talking about. And we focused on disparities between black males and white males, which are the two largest groups. We didn't divide by Hispanic ethnicity, so most Hispanics are going to be included in the white group. Our most basic research question was how much total racial disparity gets introduced in the whole post-arrest justice process, from charging through sentencing. So, like the commission then, we're also estimating gaps in sentences. But instead of controlling for the guidelines cell, we control for what the defendant was arrested for, as well as other prior characteristics. So we're estimating racial disparities in the eventual sentences between people who look the same at the beginning of the justice process, rather than people whose cases have come to look the same near the end of the process. So we control for the arrest offense, criminal history, age, education, district, defense counsel type, the number of defendants in the case, and various county level socioeconomic and crime statistics. And after controlling for all those things, we find about a 10% average black-white gap in sentence length in non-drug cases. In drug cases, it's a bit larger, about 14%. So again, those are aggregate sentencing disparities produced by the whole post-arrest process. Our next question was, at what procedural stage are those disparities entering? And we decided we couldn't cover everything in one study, so the first study focuses on the role of the initial charging decision. Our goal was to estimate how much of the racial, how much racial disparity in charging there was, and then to estimate what share of the ultimate sentencing gap could be explained by the prosecutor's initial charging decision. So the charge data consisted of the U.S. Code subsections under which the defendant was charged. We had to convert that information into quantitative scales, and we developed four different severity measures based on the statutory minimum and maximum, a guidelines-based measure, and a measure based on actual sentencing practice. I will skip the details. Yes. The problem that we ran into was that sometimes the charge data weren't specific enough because the cited statutory section would have multiple different sentencing schemes based on different fact patterns. In many cases, we were able to resolve those ambiguities with reasonable default rules about sort of the normal way that the charge was brought. But we had an irresolvable problem in drug cases because the most common single cited charge was 21 U.S.C. 841A. You all know that is not very informative as to what the defendant is charged with if you don't also know drug type and quantity. We had no fix for that. So unfortunately, we had to confine our analysis of initial charging to non-drug cases. So here's what we found. So no matter which one of the four charge severity measures we used, we found there were significant disparities in charging favoring whites. The measure that showed really dramatic disparities was the mandatory minimum. All other factors equal, black arrestees were twice as likely as whites to get charged with an offense carrying a mandatory minimum. That charging gap has sentencing consequences. Out of the 10% sentence disparity for non-drug cases that I mentioned, somewhere between half and all of it, depending on different coding decisions, can be explained by the prosecutor's choice to bring a mandatory minimum charge. We think that result is particularly striking precisely because we excluded drug cases, and you would expect that the impact of mandatory minimums would be bigger in drug cases because there are so many more of them in those cases. So if we are right about this mandatory minimum disparity, we think that cuts against the idea that expanding judicial discretion is to blame for racial disparities, because in fact it seems like the cases that drive racial disparities the most strongly are actually the ones where the judges have the least discretion, namely mandatory minimum cases. So the big question then is how to interpret our results. And we are cautious about this. We don't claim that we have proven that prosecutors discriminate on the basis of race, even unconsciously. We can't rule out the possibility that there's some real legitimate difference between black and white cases that the data just aren't capturing. We do have pretty rich data, and we use them as best as possible to test alternative explanations. For instance, our socioeconomic controls are quite strong, and we're pretty confident that it's not socioeconomic status driving these results. Our arrest data capture a pretty good amount of nuance in the facts of cases. These are not just broad arrest categories. There are 430 possible offense codes. They're quite detailed. And the data also included a text field with a written description of the offense, which we then coded, we added variables for whether that written description mentioned certain key features like guns, other weapons, conspiracy, racketeering, minor victims, police victims, and so forth. I think the main question with the arrest offense data is not whether it's detailed enough, it's whether there are racial disparities at the arrest stage that affect who gets arrested and what they get arrested for. And that's an important limitation of our study. We're not really covering the whole justice process, we're covering the post-arrest justice process. So, you know, we don't have a solution for that. The data don't tell us what the defendant actually did. The arrest offense is the closest proxy that we have. In order for arrest stage disparities to explain away the racial disparity that we found, however, you would have to believe that racial disparities at the arrest stage significantly favor black men. And if the disparities in arrest cut against black men, I think this is a point that Brian may talk about, then we are actually underestimating the total amount of disparity in the justice process because we're leaving that part out. So I want to close by quickly mentioning two other studies using the same data that I'm in the process of finishing. This is cutting edge news. They should be released in working paper form in the next few weeks. The first is a study on gender. Gender disparities favor women, and we too find that they are very large, in fact, larger than previous studies have found because we also take into account the part stemming from prosecutorial decisions. We find more than a 60% gender gap in sentences that can't be explained by the observed variables. That gap is bigger among blacks. Black men get 75% longer sentences than black women, all else equal. So I mention this even though this panel is about race, because I think it's important to understand the interaction between race and gender. So if we are worried about the jaw-dropping rates of incarceration among young black men, we should consider gender disparity potentially as one of the dimensions of that problem. Now, of course, the gender gap may be because of legitimate unobserved differences between men and women. I do the best that I can in this paper to tease those things out, like the role of childcare responsibilities. As far as I can tell, those are partial explanations, but not complete explanations for the very large gap. If I'm right about that, it suggests that if black men were treated like black women, a lot fewer of them would be in prison. And that's something that people who care about racial disparities should think about. The other new study is about Booker and race. Our method of studying Booker is different from the Sentencing Commission and other studies, and not just because of the problem that I've already discussed. I'm afraid that we have yet another criticism. So what these studies do, typically, is to compare the average disparities across pretty broad time periods. So those slides that Judge Castillo showed you show these post-Kuhn, post-Protect, post-Booker, post-Gaul periods. Those periods are pretty long, though. They're each at least a couple of years. And the problem is that comparing average disparities that are averaged across quite long periods of time have a difficult time disentangling the effects of the intervening events, like Booker, from the possibility that there's just a background trend of changing disparity that doesn't have anything to do with those events. If you hypothetically assume that racial disparity was increasing in a straight line every month linearly from 2003 on, and assume that that trend is completely unaffected, it does not change, due to Booker and due to Kimbrough and Gaul, the average disparity that you would see would be the highest in the later years because it's increasing over time. And that's going to mean it's highest in the post-Gaul period and second highest in the post-Kimbrough period and third highest in the pre-Booker period. And that would be true even if Booker and Kimbrough and Gall slowed down the rate of increase. If you had it increasing steeply and then increasing shallowly and then plateauing, the average would still be higher in the last period. So those averages can really trick you. What we do instead is we look at, in more detail, at the month-to-month trends. And we ask whether there's a sharp discontinuity in those trends right around Booker. So there's several key dates in a criminal case, and we take advantage of that to try to disentangle the effects of Booker on different parts of the justice process. So to figure out what Booker did to both sentencing fact-finding and sentencing, we look at what happens when the sentencing date passes Booker. And then we look at to figure out what Booker did to charging, we look at what happens when the charging date passes Booker. And what we find is actually suggestive evidence of a reduction in racial disparity when the sentencing date passes Booker. That is the opposite of most studies' conclusions about the effect of judicial discretion. We are very cautious about this result, however. It is statistically significant and fairly large, but it might just be a temporary blip that settles down a few months after Booker. And also figuring out Booker's causal effects is very difficult because you have to disentangle this chaos that occurred between Blakely and Booker. So what happens at Booker might be the effect of shifting to advisory guidelines, or it might be the effect of the Supreme Court settling of a major period of chaos. So the truth is we'll probably never really know for sure what Booker did to racial disparity. I can say that we don't find any evidence that racial disparity increased, though, and that we are respectfully skeptical of the evidence that other studies have provided.
And this is a junior faculty member, so Brian.
Well, I want to join Judge Castillo in commending the circuit and the planners of this conference for allocating time to this topic. I'm really energized by your willingness to engage in a conversation about racial disparities. I'd like to put this in a broader historical context. I'm someone who believes that the courts are at the heart of the question about how we address racial inequality. I think the court's tolerance of racial inequality and injustice frames the rest of the country's tolerance. I think the court's responsiveness frames the rest of the country's responsiveness. And that's why I think this issue has huge implications outside of the people of color or the others that are directly affected by this. I think this issue actually deals with the integrity of the courts, the legitimacy of the courts, the identity of the courts as guardians of what it means to be equal, to be just. And that question, I think, is a fundamental question when you look at these issues. I'd like to put this whole question of mass incarceration in a broader historical context. Scholars are now talking about four institutions that have shaped the lives, and this is really specific or particular to people to African Americans, but there's comparable analyses for other racial minorities. We talk about institutional forces that are shaping the lives of racial minorities in this country. And with regard to African Americans, we talk about four institutions. We talk about the institution of slavery, of course, where for many, many years, decades, we created a race consciousness in America that was quite unique. Many countries in the world had slaves. There were slave societies throughout Europe. But the slavery in the Americas was very distinct. It was racialized in a way where being a slave wasn't just being a subordinate. It wasn't just being in a position of servitude. It meant that you were inferior. It was a caste system, and it was a caste system that was defined not by task, but by race. And the legacy of a racialized caste system isn't easily addressed by simply eliminating slavery. And so for many of us, the legacy of slavery has really never been fully addressed, fully understood, or fully confronted. Now, the second institution that followed slavery was the era of terror that marked the end of Reconstruction and lasted until World War II. And I use that word quite deliberately. The United States went through an era of domestic terrorism that shaped the lives of African Americans. I spent a lot of time in the Black Belt of the Deep South, and older people of color come up to me all the time, and they say, Mr. Stevenson, you go and give those speeches, and they say, I get so angry when I hear people on television talking about how we're dealing with terrorism for the first time in our nation's history after 9/11. They say, I grew up with terrorism. We had to worry about being bombed. We had to worry about being lynched. We had to worry about racial violence. It's the reason why we segregated ourselves on the other side of the railroad tracks. And terror was the defining reality for these communities. They were worrying about lynching. They were worrying about hate crimes. They were worrying about the Klan. And these realities were unbelievably formative in their thinking, their acculturation, their orientation to the larger society. My parents grew up during this era, and for a long time, we were never permitted to go outside after dark because there was a presumption that that's when other people were supposed to control things. And it was very sort of misguiding, very sort of hard for me to understand, but it was rooted in this history. And this era of terror is the second institution that we're increasingly identifying. The third institution, of course, was Jim Crow, a racialized segregation using the law to subordinate people on the basis of race. That was deconstructed in the 1960s and 70s. I don't actually think we've actually confronted that institution either. The legacy of Jim Crow is something that we have a hard time talking about in the United States. Most countries that have gone through decades of racial oppression and racial segregation, of apartheid and discrimination, have recognized that you cannot survive these kinds of problems without committing yourself to a process of truth and reconciliation. In South Africa, after apartheid, there was a recognition that the country could not move forward without a commitment to truth and reconciliation. And that means that you actually tell the truth about all of the damage that you've done with all of this racialized thinking. You allow people to give voice to the trauma, the suffering, the humiliation, the marginalization that went with being on the outside. All of those injuries, all of those cuts and bruises that were suffered every time you had to deal with your inferior status. And you give voice to what it means to move forward, and you can't get to reconciliation without that. Rwanda's going through a similar process following the genocide. We never did that in this country. And because of that, there are these lasting tensions and frustrations and difficulties that I believe continue to compromise our ability to think and talk honestly about race. Well, the fourth institution is mass incarceration. It is being argued that the effects of mass incarceration are having the same debilitating, deconstructing, and consequential effects as these prior institutions. And even though that may seem dramatic, when you actually look at the data, it's quite powerful. Judge Gertner's data has, I think, been really important to recognize the consequences of this increase in mass incarceration. And it's worth noting that this is a relatively recent phenomenon. In 1972, America's jail and prison population was 300,000. Today it is 2.3 million. That doesn't even count the nearly 6 million people on probation and parole. Having the world's highest rate of incarceration is significant, but its impact on communities of color is doubly more significant. There are these collateral consequences. In 1996, Congress passed the Welfare Reform Act, which actually made it legal for states to bar people with drug convictions from receiving public benefits. In our lifetime, in the last 20 years, we've actually created a new class of people in American society. There are still 20 states that will not provide food stamps to people with drug convictions. Public housing, not allowed. Certain kinds of medical benefits, not allowed. The community of people most directly affected by this are actually women with small children. And these folks have become, in my judgment, our new untouchables. They are beneath our benefit system. They are outside of our public safety system. And because of that, their status does not allow them to get even the meager resources that are provided to the poorest of the poor. There are other collateral consequences. Voting. My state of Alabama, 37% of the black male population has permanently lost the right to vote. We're actually projecting in the next 10 years in the state of Alabama, we will have a higher level of voter disenfranchisement among African-American men in some communities than existed before the passage of the Voting Rights Act. And yet there is this appalling silence. Other consequences, all of the difficulties that you see with convictions and how it changes your life expectancy and employment, but the statistic and the concern that I have is actually borne out in one of Judge Gertner's slides. It's actually the hopelessness, this slide about your expectation of incarceration if you're the child of someone incarcerated. One of my great frustrations as a lawyer is working in communities of color with young kids who tell me by the time they're 13 and 14 that they expect to either be dead by the time they're 21 or to be in prison. And this expectation of incarceration is not something that they're making up. It's not something that they're feigning. They see their brothers, siblings, neighbors effectively dying by being sent away to prison for the rest of their lives, and there is this sense of inevitability about incarceration. And they will say to me, Mr. Stevenson, I've got to go out here and get mine while I can. I can't be worried about staying in school. I can't be bothered with these things. And this narrative about the inevitability of incarceration, the inevitability of a bad police encounter, is so powerful that it disrupts all of the conventional strategies for intervention. And I think it is one of the most troubling aspects of the legacy of mass incarceration. Well, courts have been central to confronting these historical problems. The court sustained and tolerated racial injustice. You can look at the Dred Scott decision. You can look at the court's decision to strike down the Civil Rights Act of 1870 that would have advanced and protected people of color who had been recently released from slavery. We could talk about the Supreme Court's decision in 1987 when asked to confront the problems of racial bias in the death penalty. And the court, in a very divided opinion, upheld dramatic evidence of racial disparities in the death penalty. Two reasons were advanced by the court. Justice Powell, who wrote for the majority, said if we deal with racial disparities in the administration of the death penalty, it's going to be just a matter of time before we have to deal with racial disparities in other kinds of criminal sentencing. And Justice Brennan ridiculed the court's analysis in his dissent as, quote, a fear of too much justice. And in many ways, he was right. The court was very concerned about the implications of confronting racial disparities, even in the death penalty context. The second thing the court said was a certain amount of bias, certain quantum of discrimination is, in the court's opinion, inevitable. And I agree with the writer of that opinion, Justice Powell himself, when he later said that that was a very wrong decision. Tragically misguided decision, and I'm worried about what that will create for our ability to confront racial inequality in our society. Well, McCleskey is still the law of the land, and so I do believe that the courts play a critical role in confronting this issue. Now, the court has also been a critical player in responding to these issues. In Yikwo, the court recognized that creating statutes that disenfranchised and burdened Chinese Americans in the Bay Area could not be reconciled with a commitment to equal protection. In Brown versus Board of Education, the court recognized that tolerating racial segregation in school systems could not be reconciled to a commitment to equal justice. I'm a product of Brown. I grew up in a community where black children couldn't go to the public schools. I started my education in the colored school. And the legacy of that commitment, the manifestation of that commitment, is not lost on me when there was a willingness to engage. Well, what does that mean for crime disparities in the conversation that we're having today? I think what that means is that we have not only a big challenge, but a big opportunity to confront the most vexing issues in our society today. I absolutely believe that the tolerance of racial inequality, the tolerance of these kinds of disparate outcomes, is related to many of the issues that vex and undermine our ability to confront honestly of the legacy of inequality. Let me just suggest some things for our discussion later. One of the things that the federal courts in particular have been criticized for is creating these dynamics around race in the 1970s through discretion, and the response was to create a regime of mandatory laws. I want to first suggest that there is no way to eliminate discretion in the criminal justice system. The question is, who will exercise most of that discretion? When you take it away from judges, you give it to prosecutors. When you regulate it at the prosecutorial level and the police level, you're guessing in the dark because their discretion, their judgments are not frequently seen and understood. And there are a growing group of scholars that say, no, let's give it to the judges where at least we can evaluate what's going on. Now we can't see. And this question of discretion is a really critical one. The work that I've been doing recently has been focused on children sentenced to life imprisonment without parole. We've just gotten these rulings from the Supreme Court. What's not well understood is that if you look at the number of children who've been sentenced to die in prison, life without parole, who are 14 years of age or younger, 80% of them are black or brown. And that's mostly in jurisdictions that have mandatory sentencing and mandatory transfer. Well, how is that happening? It's happening through the discretion that Professor Starr was talking about. The second thing let me suggest for our conversation is that when we give in, when we actually absorb all of these disparities, some really disturbing things happen. Increasingly, within minority communities, there is a very rigorous conversation going on about how you prepare children for this world where racial inequality is a part of what they must deal with. Do you tell black children when they're born that they are born with a presumption of guilt? Do you educate them on how to live in a society where they are presumed dangerous? Do you teach them how to navigate encounters with people where they are thinking about their perception as being dangerous or guilty? As an advocate, I tell my lawyers all the time, don't discount the presumption of guilt that your client will face going into court. If we don't talk about it, if we don't think about it, we'll be convicted by it. Third, let me suggest that the bias, the implicit bias that goes with these kinds of presumptions, not unique to non-minorities, it's shared by everybody in society, requires a very proactive response. We cannot deal with these kinds of biases without very proactive things. We've done some better in creating diversity, but not nearly anything that's going to achieve the kind of perspective that I think is critically needed. One of the areas for the federal courts in particular to consider around these diversity issues I'm going to suggest we discuss has to do with juries. Juries is one of the areas where the courts have always said you've got to have a proportionate representation of the various groups in the community. If the community is 20% Latino, the jury pool should be 20% Latino. Most federal judicial districts do not meet that requirement. There are measurable disparities with regard to racial minorities in most federal judicial districts. The question we've been asking is that a function of intentional discrimination? And we ask a set of questions around some case law that suggests that if there is intentional discrimination, we'll remedy that. I'm going to suggest that if we're really committed to doing something about this legacy, these issues, that we shouldn't be asking, is there intentional discrimination against minorities? But we should be asking, is there a commitment to full diversity, to fulfilling the law's expectation that there be proportionate representation? We can now actually achieve that through technology, through weighting mechanisms. Some states like Minnesota have employed this, and the consequences have been quite remarkable. And finally, I'm going to suggest that on this question of sentencing broadly, when we talk about guidelines, we've never done a very good job in actually appreciating what mitigation, what sentencing factors really matter. As a lawyer who does a lot of death penalty cases, I've always been struck by the statutory mitigating circumstances are never the mitigating circumstances that lawyers are trying to prove. They're never the mitigating circumstances that juries find. They're always the non-statutory things. And what we've learned is that if you tell a person's story, if you put their life in a narrative context, you actually get the sentencer to think very differently about the things that we think we're focusing on. And so if I tell you to focus on future dangerousness or focus on remorse, you're going to find that there are going to be some consequences to who is found to be dangerous in the future and who's found to be adequately remorseful. If I ask you to focus on abuse or neglect or narratives of trauma and abuse and disadvantage, the question of remorse is a very different question. The question of future dangerousness is a very different question. And I'm going to suggest that our ability to articulate what's relevant for the purposes of sentencing needs to be radically re-altered and less defined by the prototypical things that we've tended to think about. And finally, I'll end with this. I think that there is something really powerful about appreciating where we are in this larger historical narrative. I think that there is something quite empowering about recognizing what history has to teach us about the utility of humility when it comes to confronting legacies of racial inequality. I gave some lectures in Germany a few years ago on the death penalty and racial bias, and when I finished the lectures, I was really struck by one of the German scholars who got up and felt the need to respond, and what she said was, you know, this is really interesting what you're talking about, and she said, of course, we don't have the death penalty in Germany. And the room got very quiet, and she said, and we will never have the death penalty in Germany. And she said, our experience with the Holocaust means that we can never again engage in the systematic killing of human beings. And there was something quite really striking to me hearing this person say that. And I started thinking about it, and on my flight back from Germany to Alabama, I started thinking, what would it feel like to live in a world where the nation state of Germany was still engaged in executing people? And what would it feel like if the people they were disproportionately executing were Jewish? And the more I thought about it, the more I became quickly enraged. I told myself I couldn't make peace with a world where that was going on. I just wouldn't be able to sustain it. And then I got off the plane in Alabama and I began walking around in a state where buried in the ground are the bodies of thousands of people who've been lynched. And I went to our death row, which is 80% African American, and I began focusing on all of these racial disparities. And I asked the question, why? Why aren't we more informed by our history? Isn't there some humility around confronting this legacy? And what can we do to change that? I think the beginning to changing that really is these kinds of conversations. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to be a part of this one, and I hope that they will continue, not just during your conference, but in the work that you do moving forward. Thank you.
What can I say? I can tell you this. I tend to be an optimist, and you couldn't serve on the Sentencing Commission for 11 years without being optimistic and trying not to get demoralized. So I'm going to try and end my comments on sort of an up note. I agree with Brian and also with Professor Starr that these are key moments to have a discussion about race in the criminal justice system. And everything is really set up. All the building blocks are there for advocacy and for judges to use their discretion. But before I even get to that, a couple of other sobering notes. One is the problem, the persistent problem of mandatory minimums. In my 11 years on the Sentencing Commission, I was a strong advocate against the use of mandatory minimum sentences. In fact, I've had this debate many a time with people like Senator Feinstein, others who really believe that mandatory minimums are needed. And if you really look at the history of how federal sentencing evolved, there's a total disconnect between the promulgation of the sentencing guidelines, even if they were in their old mandatory sort of way, and the rapid enactment of mandatory sentences. It's like there's a total disconnect between those two things. And you could say, well, why is that important? Well, I can tell you this. The Sentencing Commission released a report. It's another report that didn't get a whole lot of publicity. 27% of the cases in the federal system are affected by the mandatory minimum penalties that Congress has enacted. And I wish I could tell you that Congress will no longer enact mandatory minimums, but that's not the case. And yet when you look at who gets charged with these mandatory minimums, I can tell you the Sentencing Commission report found that Hispanic offenders accounted for the largest group, 38.3% of the offenders convicted of an offense carrying a mandatory minimum penalty, followed by black offenders at 31.5, and then the rest just followed from there. But then when you looked at who got relief, that is under the safety valve or some cooperation from the mandatory minimum penalty, black offenders got the least relief from the mandatory minimum penalties. So that tells me that we have to acknowledge that there is a prosecutorial discretion part to this problem that really needs to be addressed. And I hope that it does get addressed. And I think it's incumbent on defense attorneys, prosecutors, to be careful about the type of charging decisions that exist in the federal criminal justice system. And it is incumbent on judges, as hard as it may be, and I know it's easier for me to say this in a district like Illinois, but if we see unfair plea agreements, we need to reject them. I mean, that is our obligation, as Brian says, to make this system a fair system. So that's number one. I need to say a little bit about that. But I also want to say that this is being carefully studied, and one thing that caught my attention was a review that was written in the New York Review of Books by our former Circuit Justice, John Paul Stevens. Now, when John Paul Stevens is writing a review, it's something I pay attention to. And one of the reviews that he recently wrote was about William Stuntz's book entitled The Collapse of the American Criminal Justice System. And this is how former Justice Stevens entitled this. William Stuntz was a popular and well-respected Henry J. Friendly professor of law at Harvard University. He finished his manuscript of The Collapse of the American Criminal Justice System shortly before his untimely death earlier this year, meaning 2011. The book is, this is Justice Stevens saying this, eminently readable and merits careful attention because it accurately describes the twin problems that pervade the American criminal justice system today. Its overall severity and its disparate treatment of African Americans. And then I'm just gonna read you one other part that Justice Stevens mentions. The result, Stuntz writes, has been serious disadvantage to African Americans in their encounters with the American criminal justice system. While only 10% of the adult black population uses illegal drugs, as does a roughly equal percentage, 9%, of the adult white population, blacks are nine times more likely than whites to serve prison sentences for drug crimes. And the same system that discriminates against black drug defendants also discriminates against black victims of criminal violence. That is just not a criminal justice system that I think any one of us wants to be part of. And so, are there things being done? I think the answer is resoundingly yes. I mean, one of the things that we have to acknowledge, me coming from Chicago and being here in Hawaii, is that we have a different president for the first time who has appointed a different attorney general. And Attorney General Holder wants to look at taking out the disparate treatment of different defendants in the federal criminal justice system. I mean, I have here an interesting document that you can take a look at to show you how timely this is. This is a July 23rd, 2012 letter that was written by the Department of Justice to Chair Patty Saris at the Sentencing Commission. And this talked about the following. The imperative to increase the productivity of public safety expenditures in an era of governmental austerity. Something I know that's been talked about at this conference, but the reality is we need to do better about how we're spending money to incarcerate individuals. We're just basically losing our credibility as an American criminal justice system if we don't eliminate some of these unwarranted sentencing disparities in the use of our limited criminal justice resources at this point in time. And Attorney General Holder believes in his letter to Patty Saris that federal criminal justice sentencing policy should be reviewed systematically and on a crime-by-crime basis through the lens of public safety spending, but also through the lens of eliminating this racial disparity that exists. So this is as timely as it gets. And I think the advocates in this room are armed. They're armed with Supreme Court opinions. Two Supreme Court opinions that come to mind are the Pepper and Gall decisions, which emphasize the individual need of treating defendants based on the individual characteristics. And I think it's incumbent on judges in particular to take a close look at criminal history. When I'm looking at criminal history, I'm looking at gaps that exist in criminal history and whether or not I can make a prediction, a very valid judicial prediction, that this defendant before me is worth taking a chance on. And what I'm looking for are time periods that this defendant has gone without offending. Because if there are such time periods in an individual's criminal history, I think a departure for criminal history that can have a big factor in figuring out the adjusted guideline range can really have a big net benefit to an individual defendant. So I would hope that all of you would look at that. I also have to point out that your circuit justice sort of has led the charge in evaluating sentencing. Justice Kennedy, of course, voted the right way in reversing my circuit on whether or not the Fair Sentencing Act should be fully retroactive. And I'm happy to sit here and say that just last month in the Dorsey opinion, the Fair Sentencing Act was made fully retroactive. And I am hopeful that the Sentencing Commission will carefully study those crack offenders that are being released out there today that are not creating public safety problems out there. Because if they were, I guarantee you, you'd see that New York Times page one story. That isn't happening. It's a great untold story of the American criminal justice system that we've released thousands of crack offenders and they've done well. Part of the reason for that is another judge in your circuit who's led the charge, and of course I'm talking about Judge Ann Aiken, who's led the charge on reentry programs. And you've seen those reentry programs, thank you for that, and thank you to Ann. Those reentry programs are being duplicated all over the country. So there's a lot of good news out there. In fact, I've duplicated a program in Chicago. It was just mentioned today. Today, as I sit here in the Chicago Tribune, there was public coverage for the first time. Now, I didn't arrange that, just one of those godsend things, but it did happen. And there's a lot of efforts being made out there by good-minded people to do better about race and reentry and what we're doing. So I'm hopeful that this discussion will be part of a movement that will be duplicated by other circuits. So I'll stop right there. Thank you.
My goal here is to ask a few questions of the panel and then open it up to the extent we have any time. Let me start with Judge Castillo, though. Your chart,
mm-hmm.
which seems to suggest that when discretion came in, racial disparities increase, is directly contradictory to some degree, Professor Starr's research and to even what Professor Stevenson, I'm going to make you a full professor, Stevenson suggested, which is that to some degree, discretion today, not the way it was 40 years ago, discretion today may be one of the ways that judges, in fact, account for problems in the system. The prosecutor who overcharged, the cooperation agreement that was not offered to the black guy that was offered to the white guy. So isn't there a risk that when the commission talks about Booker, Gall, discretion goes up, and race discrimination goes up, what's going to happen is a political movement that shuts down judicial discretion once again. Isn't that a danger in these kind of statistics?
There definitely is that danger, Nancy, and that's something that's discussed all the time at the Sentencing Commission. And you know, people, right-minded people, will disagree as to whether or not some of these studies can be used that way. But in the end, when our researchers at the Sentencing Commission have these findings that have been replicated, maybe not to the same degree, but by every other single researcher in the country, I think the decision was made at the Sentencing Commission. It is their obligation to release it, regardless of the political consequences that might have. So there are some who think that, of course, the commission is trying to release that type of data so that we can go back to a mandatory system. That is the furthest thing that I, when I was at the commission, wanted to do. There may have been some people at the commission trying to accomplish that goal. I don't know that.
Let me just as a follow-up question,
yep.
And this is, I think I'll ask all the judges in the room mm-hmm. as well. I remember the statement of reasons form. That Sentencing Commission's data comes from the sentencing reasons form. And the Sentencing Commission reason form, sentencing statement of reasons rather, has a checkoff for all the guideline categories. But when you get to Booker, there are three or four categories that are really incredibly illustrative. 3553A, check. Oh, that gives a lot of information. The circumstances, the nature of the offender and the circumstance of the offense, even more information. And when you finish all those checks, then there's a box. And I know in my court, and it's public, there were judges who would depart and write in the box for all the reasons specified in the statute, period. So that if the commission wants to account for why there are these differences, it needs to be able to capture from the judges why there are these differences. If you have varied because of education or you varied because of employment and you don't write it down, they don't have any way of knowing that that was the reason and it becomes an unexplained difference. Is there any movement afoot to change this form?
I think there's always been movement, dissatisfaction with the form. Part of it was the interaction between the Sentencing Commission and the Judicial Conference. We all would love judges to write about their sentencing decisions, but we're also realistic that, especially if you're serving along the U.S.-Mexican border, it's just not realistic. We applauded all your opinions. They were all carefully looked at. But every judge, we understand, is in a different situation with regard to their criminal caseload, and that's part of the situation that we're confronted with.
Well, let me ask Brian for a moment. On the one hand, you say the sentencing guidelines were famously triggered by something that Marvin Frankel, a judge and then became a professor, said, which is part of the problem here is that the bench was largely, this was way back in the 70s, the bench was largely white. They were largely corporate lawyers. They largely had no idea about criminal justice issues. And they sentenced people who looked like themselves better than they sentenced people that they didn't know. Yet you say that in some measure, discretion is an antidote for the kinds of issues that that Sonia was talking about. How do you reconcile that?
Well, I think that it's really important to recognize that this whole effort is part of a larger, broader national effort that I think has been fueled by what I characterize as the politics of fear and anger. We have had a political agenda in this country for over 40 years that has simply been focused on criminalizing more and more behavior, punishing more harshly. We've created benchmarks with the terms of sentencing that are very difficult for people to recover from. We're in a political culture where no one is offering much leadership on how we retreat from mass incarceration. No person running for office is going to commit to trying to reduce the prison population by 50% in the next 10 years, when that's exactly what I think we need. And so that political environment has meant that we're constantly looking for the person we trust the least to disempower. And so in the 1970s, at this era when there seemed to be chaos, we pointed to the judges. We said, we don't trust them. And there was this, I think, very misguided collaboration made with some people, even in the civil rights community, to say precisely what you said. They don't understand these communities, therefore we don't trust them. It's true that there are these problems. There is this bias, implicit and conscious, but it's true throughout the system. And my argument is that if we can acknowledge it, we can address it. In the police and prosecutorial context, as was made earlier, we have so much less access. We don't have the kind of access. And consequently, I would rather have that bias, even if it's very overt bias, in plain view, and so we could address it in that way. I also think that any forum that gives you an opportunity to get outside of this political environment of fear and anger is a forum that you prefer. And the courts tend to be that. Even the most resistant judges, for me, create a better audience than this political environment where you can't even speak rationally about these issues. Give me the chance to give the narrative of my client's life, and if you can't hear it because you think that people from that part of the community are just forgotten or worthless or beyond hope or beyond redemption, I'll try to deal with that. But in the broader context, you have no opportunity. We don't get to advocate with police at arrests. We're not in the room when they make charging decisions. We don't see the discretionary judgments. So we've got to create a forum where there's an opportunity to be seen and heard, and that's why I think, despite that reality, creating discretion in the forum of the courtroom, in an open forum, is a better way to move forward than what we have currently.
And then just... And then to Sonia, I know that I'm taking you out of the role of an academic for a moment, but that's okay. What's the answer to what you're describing? Should there have been, when the sentencing guidelines were initially promulgated, there was a discussion of getting information about charging practices, recognizing that discretion is hydraulic. If you limit it at one end, it'll come out in the other. and in not only getting sentencing information from, or charging information from prosecutors, but also guidelines for prosecutors. Would that work?
Well, so the charging disparities that we found during 2007 through 2009 all existed during a period when a memo from Attorney General Ashcroft was on the books, essentially telling prosecutors that they had no charging discretion. It said, you have to charge the most serious, readily provable offense in all cases, and you can't drop it afterwards without special permission from your supervisor. This was, you know, the most ambitious ever attempt to retract discretion from line prosecutors. And yet these disparities still exist. And we actually looked, when we were looking at these trends over time in the Booker study, at like what happened at the Ashcroft memo, and the answer was like not very much in either charging or conviction. It doesn't seem to have really changed prosecutorial practices. And I think that is a sign that prosecutorial discretion is just very difficult to constrain, because in the end, main justice, or even the supervising attorney, is not the one that has to make the call about what offenses are readily provable, right? There's always going to be discretion in the system. And I don't think we would want a system in which prosecutors had no discretion, right? We have an extremely harsh, discretion is essentially the power to be lenient, right? We have a really harsh criminal justice system as it is. If we said inflexibly, you can't try to accommodate the individual circumstances of cases, it would be harsher, and I don't think that would be a service to people of color, or anybody really. And so I think it might be more about maybe taking away some of the tools that have the most adverse consequences. I would like to get rid of 924C, or at least the mandatory minimum portions of it. Certainly the stacking portions. I mean, there are just sort of insane things in the laws that ought to be fixed, that are sort of structurally built in into the system. And then maybe, you know, if you want to change prosecutorial behavior rather than just taking away tools, maybe the best thing to do is just, you know, to try to collect information, to just try to raise awareness, because I think our U.S. attorneys and assistant U.S. attorneys are good people who are trying to do a good job. I don't think they're racists. Like, I think that maybe, educating people more about racial disparities and the role of these decisions in shaping them, you know, could be an important part of the process.
Okay, I'm my fearless leader has told me that we could have questions in the 5 minutes remaining. Although there's a sign that says 3 minutes, so I'm thoroughly confused. But I will exercise my I'm the chair. I don't have many titles left, so I'm the chair. Judge Breyer.
Fascinating panel. What we've tried to do in our district was to have a conversation among the judges in sentencing a particular crime. Mm-hmm. For example, illegal entry crimes. And what we've done is compile statistics for our group of judges, which basically look at the difference in sentencing practices among members of the court for basically the same offense. Now, it could be argued that, gee, that's going to make judgments more uniform and maybe at a higher end than a lower judgment. But it's been our experience that once judges have to talk to other judges and explain the real reasons why they're sentencing a particular defendant a particular way. And once those reasons are questioned by our colleagues, rather than by an adversary that appears in front of us, then there is an attempt by the judges to reevaluate their sentencing decisions, and especially in lines of the severity of sentences. Have you done any studies that have explored within districts whether this process of discussion among the judges of the same district disclosed disparities, disclosed discriminatory practices?
There's a historical answer and a current answer. The historical answer is before the sentencing guidelines, there was something called sentencing councils that mostly were tried in the Southern District of New York. And they were not given a long enough time to play out, but that was part of the issue. It's almost like when you step back from it, it's like peer review for docs. Discretionary decisions that doctors make, they make judgments, and then there's peer review where others say, gee, I think that's good or bad. And it changes the forum, changes the framework. There's some efforts to do this again in New York to come up with sentencing councils. And in Massachusetts, one thing which we did, which I commend to everyone, we would ask the judges for the most difficult sentencing decisions that they had. And what came up was pornography, crack cocaine cases, career offender cases. And I would put together hypotheticals. And we'd have all the judges of the District of Massachusetts in a room and say, here's a hypothetical, what would you do? And we talked about it. And people would raise, this was not necessarily in a particular case, but a common law of sentencing, which is a favorite law rule, concept of mine, evolved in that room, and evolved in that room in a non-coercive way. So there are ways to do that. Anyone else want to add?
Well, the ABA currently has a task force focused on racial bias in sentencing, where that methodology is specifically what they're recommending courts to consider. And they're actually doing it both with sitting judges within circuits where they facilitate these conversations and get people to talk about why these disparities exist. But they're also being very intentional about identifying racial disparity as one of the goals that they're trying to eliminate. I think the process is very, very valuable, incredibly important. But I also think it's really useful to be intentional and vocal and verbal about the goal of eliminating racial disparities, because I think when that construct is out there, you actually can have a conversation about some of the underlying presumptions, implicit bias and unconscious bias. The remedy that to all of the scholars who have been working in that field recommend is to make these implicit biases apparent and verbal and vocal and visible, and that's the step that gets us closer. And I think that process, which is a process that's now being employed by this task force of the ABA, is a really useful one.
Yes.
My name is Tom Hillier, and I'm the federal public defender in Seattle. And my question is prompted by sort of not only this discussion, but it was ratified to some extent in an article that was mentioned in Doug Berman's blog this morning called Reality Challenge Philosophies of Punishment by Robert Weisberg. And the premise of his article is that our current guideline-dominated system of punishment is dominated by retribution. That's why we have mass incarceration now, to the exclusion of other purposes of sentencing. And the reality is that as a result, we have all these other problems. With voting rights in communities, family problems, employability after going to prison for just 9 months or whatever just might be. And what I'm wondering is, in the wake of Booker and Gall and Kimbrough, can and should courts take into account in sentencing people and addressing mass incarceration some of these other issues that aren't client-specific or case-specific, but you know, these are problems we have, and rather than, you know, pile on, I'm going to not give you a prison sentence. Can and should judges be able to do that?
You mean take into account the general pattern?
Yes, right. You know, I mean, you're going to hopefully tie it somewhat into the story, the narrative of this client that's before this court, but should and can judges take these larger reality-based challenges into consideration in sentencing people to alternatives to imprisonment?
That's a little hard for judges to sort of intone on policy issues, which is really what you're saying. But in other words, to say, I'm going to sentence you to, what, two years rather than 10 because I'm concerned about mass incarceration would be a difficult, and I don't know where you'd put that on the form. That would be a problem. But there is a way of addressing that. Towards the end of my tenure as a judge, lawyers would come before me and argue that public safety demands that Mr. X, drug dealer, be in jail. And I would say, you know, public safety is actually a richer discussion than that. Public safety might demand that he be with his family. Public safety might demand that we work to help him reconstruct his life. In other words, if to the extent that the public safety debate is being played out in front of you, then it seems to me you can address it. And then there's something that Ryan said, which is, you know, if you're concerned about the prosecutorial practices and why someone's getting a deal and someone isn't, you certainly can raise that. How to sentence based on that is a more difficult issue.
I mean, I guess I just wanted to add that I agree that ideally you want the political branches to be making policy, right? But I read United States v. Kimbrough as saying that the that judges can sentence differently on the basis of policy disagreements with the guidelines. Now, whether that means they can just say or should just say, in general, I don't like incarceration, and so I just right. won't sentence anybody to it.
That would be a problem.
That's a little broad, right? But there may be particular areas in which the guidelines are, you know, like in the crack case might be producing bad policy outcomes, and I think the Supreme Court has said that that is something that judges can take into account, so long, of course, as they comply with the sentencing statutes with Section 3553, et cetera.
Yeah, and I would just add, I think that we, in fact, do engage in that kind of thinking all the time in sentencing, and it just depends on how you characterize it. If I have a client who is 18, but has been admitted to Stanford University, but has been arrested on a drug offense, I'm going to argue that this young person has tremendous potential. The fact that he's been admitted to Stanford should be expressly considered by the judge in making a determination about what should happen to him. And that consequence is going to be something that I highlight. If I have a client who's a single parent with three small children with a drug arrest, and the consequence of her incarceration will mean that these three children will go into a foster care system mm-hmm. where these children are likely to be traumatized, abused, disrupted, cycled in and out, that we will be spending, you know, tens of thousands of dollars to incarcerate her for a nonviolent property crime worth less than $100. I think it's equally appropriate to consider the bad outcomes that will follow a sentencing decision in that context. We recognize the importance and utility of educational achievement. We just don't recognize equally the consequences of poverty and abuse and marginalization. And so I think we do it all the time. I think we should do it. I just think we should do it more carefully, more thoughtfully, more attentively to the plight of the poor, the marginalized, and the disaffected. You don't really judge, in my view, the commitment to the rule of law, even the character of sentencing, by how you treat the privileged and the powerful and the rich. You judge it by how you treat the poor, the disfavored, the disempowered. And that's the true test, it seems to be.
I hate to cut off this fabulous discussion, but we do have to move on to our next program. We'd like to thank our panel very much.